Hi, welcome to PM School's YouTube channel. In this channel, we're going to be starting a new series. We're terming it The Explainers. The intent of this entire series is to break down common product management concepts and explain them to you in a very simple manner so that you guys can understand and use them in practice. In today's video, we will take a look at what the Circles framework is all about. Circles is a very common framework that candidates use to answer design questions in PM interviews. As part of this entire video, I will take you through what the Circles framework is about, when and where you should use it, what are some of the things to remember, and finally, I'll also solve a sample question for you using this framework so that you guys can see how it works in practice. So without any further ado, let's get started. To start off with a very basic question, what exactly is Circles? Circles is a framework that helps you solve design questions in product management interviews. So now some of you may be thinking, what exactly are probably even design questions? Design questions are those which ask you to design a specific product for a specific customer. These questions come in the form of design X for Y, where X is the product or service and Y is the customer. Some examples of these could be design Netflix for kids or design an alarm clock for people who are visually impaired. Now, why do interviewers focus on design questions and what's the purpose behind asking these? A design question generally tests you on four key areas. Number one, setting objectives and goals, which is how good are you in defining what needs to be done and why it needs to be done. Number two is customer empathy. Are you able to empathize with the customer and put yourself in their shoes to understand what they care about? Number three is prioritization. Amongst a lot of customer needs and solutions that you would come up with, are you able to prioritize based on a certain set of factors and pick one or two that you'd really want to go ahead with? And lastly, number four is creative thinking, which is how creatively can you think about how to solve or how to design this particular product? Following the Circles method helps you to cover each of these four areas in a structured manner and ensures that you don't forget any of these steps when you're answering this particular question in the interview. Circles is basically a seven-step acronym which goes like this. So whenever you're given a design question, the first step is to take a step back and comprehend the situation. This is the time where you understand the situation that you're in, ask some clarifying questions to the interviewer, and clarify any doubts that you have. The second step is to identify your users. Now, of course, the interviewer might have told you that, hey, you know, you need to focus on this particular user, but it's in your best interest to clarify this with the interviewer and also probably even try to do some sort of segmentation on this user and understand from the interviewer whether you need to focus on a specific segment or is it maybe the broader user base. Once you've clarified the situation and have understood who your user is, it's time to put yourself in their shoes and think about what their needs could be. This is a space where you showcase your customer empathy and understand what do they care about and why do they care about. So once you have these ready, it's time to take a look at all of these needs that you've listed down and probably pick one or two that you think are more critical to be solved for. Even though you might want to solve a lot of these needs or all of them, you may not have the time or money or resources in real life to go ahead with addressing all of these needs. So you have to pick one or two that really matter. Once you've prioritized the needs that you really want to be solving for, this is the time where you don your creative thinking hat and brainstorm possible solutions to solve these very needs. Once you have a few solutions in place, it is now time to look at some of the trade-offs with these solutions. The intent here is to look at all of your solutions, think about what is, say, probably their impact or maybe how complex it is to build these, and finally come up with one or maybe two solutions that you can finally go ahead with in terms of your design. Once you've completed all of these steps, it's now time to bring all of them together and present it in a logical and cohesive manner to the interviewer, along with your final recommendations. Circles is a very useful method to solve design questions, but there are a few things that you need to keep in mind. You have to remember that Circles is not a one-size-fits-all solution. It's only a memory aid to help you answer design questions and to help you go about it in a structured manner. There would be occasions where the interviewer might want you to focus more on one particular area and less on another. And so if you go by this framework, then you may not be really addressing what the interviewer really asks for. So you've got to understand that Circles is a great technique for you to think about how to solve a design question, but you have to adapt it to every interview and every question. So now that you have understood what the Circles framework is, let me take you through a sample question that I solved using this particular framework. So the question in front of us today is, design an ATM for people who are visually impaired. Now, before I proceed with the question, I want to tell you guys that in case you want to solve this question along with me, I would recommend that you pause the video right here, use the circles framework that I showed you before, solve it using a pen and paper, and then come back to watch the video. Or you could solve it with me as I go about this question. So when I first look at this question, what strikes me is that this is a fairly open-ended question, and that I probably have to ask a few clarifying questions to the interviewer in order to narrow down the scope. And this is exactly what I'll be doing in step number one, which is to comprehend the situation. So when I think about this question, there are a few things or a few areas that I really want to have some clarity on. So the first area that I'd want to have clarity on is, why are we building this product? Or what is the goal behind building this product, right? It could be that the current ATMs do not serve the needs of visually impaired people, or it could be any other goal, right? I'd want to clarify this with the interviewer, right? So the first thing that I'd want clarity on is the goal. So the second area I'd want some clarity on is on the customer. Right. I know that the interviewer said focus on people who are visually impaired, but from my understanding, I think there'd be different types of visual impairment. There is color blindness, or there could be partial impairment, or there could be full impairment. Now, I really want to know which segment of customers to really focus on, and this would be my second area that I'd want clarity on. Now, the third area that I'd really want some clarity on is on the product in itself. Because I know what probably an ATM is, but the thing is, I need to clarify this understanding with the interviewer. I know that ATMs have a few functionalities. Obviously, extracting cash is the major feature, but there are also ATMs that have features like depositing cash, and there are a whole host of other peripheral features like checking your account balance and so on. Right? I want to know, if I'm designing an ATM, what are some of the features that I really need to think and keep in mind? Right? So I'd want some clarity on that. The reason why you want to confirm this is just to ensure that you and your interviewer are on the same page. I know that sometimes it might seem a little dumb to be confirming something as simple as what an ATM is, but it will really help you because you don't know what the interviewer has in their head as to how the ATM should look like. And so it's best if you just confirm this. Now, the next thing that I'd really want to understand is, who exactly am I? If I'm going to be designing an ATM, am I a bank? Or am I, say, some software company like Google, which is designing the software inside the ATM? Or am I a hardware manufacturer, or someone who's, say, a vendor who just creates ATMs, who just manufactures the ATMs? My design and the solutions that I come up with will change based on who exactly I am, right? So I'd want to know this. Now, there's one more area that I really want some clarity on, and this is on, what sort of constraints am I working with? Constraints could be anything around money, or it could be time, or it could be resources, right? So I'd really want to know what constraints I'm working with. Essentially, what I'll do at this point is that I'd ask all of these questions to the interviewer, because I'd need clarity on all of these. Now, let's assume that the interviewer, in response to all of these questions that I asked, says this. So now that the interviewer has given me these details, this is definitely providing me with a lot more clarification. And so I kind of have an idea as to how to go about. So now what I'm going to do is, I'm going to go to the next step, which is to think about the customer, right? I'll be combining step 2 and 3. I'll identify my user, and I'll think through what are their needs, what do they really care about, and why they'll probably be caring about it. A simple tip in order for you to do a good job in this phase is to think about the customer journey in relation to them using this product. In our case, think about how a visually impaired person would transact with an ATM. Right from the first step of understanding where the ATM is, getting to the ATM, using the ATM to transact money, ensuring that the right amount is present, and maybe something else around, say, safety aspects of it as well. Right? So if you think about that, you understand each step, and you can actually bring out needs from each of these steps. And this is a very comprehensive way to think about it. So that's exactly what I'm going to do. So when I think of the user journey, right, it all starts with the visually impaired person knowing where the ATM is. Once they know where the ATM is, then they would have to get to that place. When they get to the place, then you have the entire transactional element, which is using the ATM. Now here, you would obviously go deeper into this. You have different use cases like taking money out of it. So what they probably do here is, you would swipe your debit card, you would enter your PIN, you would click a few buttons, and then you would get to the option that you want. You would maybe enter your amount, and the amount comes out, and you check the amount, and then you exit from the ATM, right? So if a blind person is doing this, then, they can swipe the card, but they wouldn't be able to really see what is there on the screen. Right? They'll have to have a touch and feel of how the ATM keypad looks like, and that's how they can probably go about this. There is that particular phase. Now, the next step is in knowing that the right amount has actually come out of the ATM. You can still see whether it's a 10 rupee note or a 100 rupee note, it's easy to differentiate. But for a visually impaired person, it's very difficult, right? So that's a big need for them. And then probably the last piece is on everything around safety, especially because someone's visually impaired, they'd have that concern in their head that, hey, you know, I fear that someone might steal the money that I have, and I don't think I feel very safe in transacting from an ATM. But that's also a very big need for this. So this is sort of the user journey that I can think of. Obviously, you, when you're thinking of a user journey, you can have multiple steps, which is completely fair. But just for the sake of time and for the sake of our sample activity, I'm just sticking to these steps. Now, the next step I need to do here is to look at these four needs and pick probably one or two that I would really want to focus on. Yeah. So the way I would do this is look at what are some of the alternatives that a visually impaired person might probably have in solving these needs, and also which ones are really more critical to be solved for. So when I look at the first need, which is locating the ATM and getting to the ATM, yes, I would think that this is an important need to be solved for, but I'd have two concerns around this. The first is that given that we are a bank, can we really be solving this particular need? Because one component of this is to be able to reach the ATM, which is more of a transportation problem. And I would really wonder whether we as a bank can actually try and solve this. The second question is around what our priorities are at this point. Could we probably spend more time in designing the in-ATM experience as our first priority and probably keep this as our second priority? Right. So these are kind of the two questions that I'd have on this specific need. I do think that this is an important need to solve for, but I would prioritize it a little bit lower. When I look at the second need, which is to be able to transact seamlessly, I would think this is a high priority need. If you can provide the ability for a visually impaired person to be able to perform all of their activities within the ATM in a seamless manner, given all of the constraints, then I think it will be a great experience for the customer. Looking at the third need, which is knowing whether the right amount has been shelled out or not, what I would think here is that firstly, the accuracy of the ATMs could already be really high. Accuracy as in terms of the amount that they calculate and shell out for you. I would say that because the accuracy is already really high, the chances of an error occurring would be pretty low. And the second thing is also that today, when you look at the notes in India, they are of different sizes and they are distinguishable by texture and feel. And so I would say that, yes, this is a problem, but I would say there are some form of alternatives that exist today to solve this particular need. When you look at the fourth need, which is safety inside an ATM, I think that this is a very high priority need, even higher than the ability to transact within the ATM. So this is something that would be very high on my list, and I would really want to prioritize this one. So now that I've done this prioritization activity, which was actually our step number 5, cutting through prioritization, I have two needs that I would want to focus on in order to build my solutions. The first one is being able to transact seamlessly. And then the second one is that we should ensure that safety is present within the ATM. When I thought about these two needs, I was able to get a few solutions in mind. Looking at the first need, which is to be able to transact seamlessly, one of the solutions that I was able to think of was an AI voice assistant, which could interact with the visually impaired person and help them perform all of their activities inside the ATM. What I mean here is something like an Alexa for an ATM. For example, if the visually impaired person wants to check their account balance, they literally have to speak to the assistant and say, I want to check account balance. And the voice assistant understands that in the back end, and it then carries out the activity for you. Or you say, I want to extract 1,000 rupees, and it automatically understands what you mean, and it can perform that action for you. So having this solution kind of removes the entire need to operate with the keypad and with the machine itself. And it just uses your voice to understand whatever that you say and perform the action that you need. The second solution that I thought of was a combination of having a Braille keypad along with a very primitive form of voice assistant. Yeah, so Braille keypad is a normal keypad, but which has the Braille markings on top to signal which particular key corresponds to what for a visually impaired person. What I mean by a primitive voice assistant is a voice-based input which tells you something like press 1 for checking account balance, press 2 for transactions, press 3 for maybe some other activity. And all you need to do is press the corresponding button on the keypad and you get the activity done. The advantage with this solution is that you have the voice that gives you directions in terms of how you operate the machine, and you can still use the keypad in order to operate that. When I think of the second need, which is safety within the ATM, one solution that I could think of is having a camera with image recognition capabilities, which identifies if more than one person is within the ATM, and if so, it can raise an alarm. This way, you would solve for the problem of someone trying to enter the ATM, maybe trying to steal the money when the visually impaired person is trying to transact. The second solution that I thought of was an ATM door lock, which is accessible only by a special card that is issued to people with visual impairment. The scenario I'm envisioning here is that when you enter the ATM, once you've closed the door behind you, you can swipe the card and lock the door and perform all of your transactions knowing that nobody's going to enter because nobody can unlock it from outside. And once you're done with all your transactions, then you can unlock the door from inside and then exit the ATM. This is a solution that I feel can really solve for the safety need. So at this point, I'm happy with the solutions that I have. I'd now want to move on to the next step, which is to evaluate the trade-offs with these solutions and pick maybe one or two that I'd want to include in my final design. The way I'd want to evaluate the trade-offs is essentially based on two main factors. One is impact and the other is complexity. Impact means what is the impact of this solution to the end user, and complexity as in how complex is it for me as a bank to be able to implement this very solution. So what I'll do is I'll give a score of high, medium or low for each of these solutions against each of those factors. And at the end, I'll look at how good these solutions are. When I look at the first solution, which is the ATM Alexa, from an impact standpoint, I would think that this would have a very high impact, because if you're able to just use the ATM with voice alone, it is solving a very big problem. I would think that it has a very high impact. From a complexity standpoint, given that we are a bank who may not really have the tech resources in order to implement the solution, I would classify this as a very highly complex solution. If you need to have this solution implemented, you would need expertise on artificial intelligence, machine learning, voice recognition, and I'm not so sure as a bank you would have all of those skills and resources. And hence I would give it a high complexity rating. Looking at the next solution, which is Braille Keypad plus Primitive Voice Assistant, again, from an impact standpoint, I would think that this is a very high impact solution. From a complexity standpoint, I wouldn't think it's a very highly complex solution to implement, because implementing your Braille marking on top of the keypad is already being done by many ATMs at this point, and so that piece is taken care of. And the other side, which is the Primitive Voice Assistant, should also be easy to implement. So I would give a medium complexity rating for this solution. The third solution, which is the image recognition plus alarm, from an impact standpoint, I would give this as medium impact, because yes, raising an alarm when someone enters the ATM is a great feature to have, but what if you raise a false alarm? What if two people enter the ATM at the same time and they are not actually strangers to each other, right? And this time you would raise a false alarm and it would be a bad experience for the user. So I would really say that the impact is not too high. When I'm thinking about the complexity angle, again, the same reason that I gave for the ATM Alexa, which is regarding the technical complexity, you would also need technical complexity in order to build this image recognition solution. And so I don't know if me as a bank would have this particular resources available with me. And so I would rate that this is a very highly complex solution to build. Now looking at the fourth solution, which is the ATM door lock. From an impact standpoint, I would say this has very high impact, because if you can lock the door, especially as a visually impaired person, and do all of your transactions without the fear of someone coming in and probably stealing your money, then we would be solving a very big problem for them. And from a complexity standpoint, I wouldn't think it is too complex to implement. What you would need is a door lock that you need to implement on the door. And you need to be able to have the mechanism to swipe on the door in order to lock or unlock the door. And I wouldn't think it's too hard to implement. So I would rate this as low to medium. Now that I've looked at each of these solutions and marked high, medium or low against each of those factors, what I now want to do is look at what are the potential problems that each of these solutions could probably bring up. And in case we have some counter solutions for those. So when I look at the first solution, which is the ATM Alexa, I think that if you're relying on a voice assistant to understand whatever you speak, you have to ensure that the voice assistant has extremely high degree of accuracy, because a misunderstanding in terms of, say, for example, if someone says, I want to transact 1,000, and for some reason, the voice assistant understands that as I want to transact 1 lakh, then that could be catastrophic and really be a very bad experience for the user. It would really reduce the adoption and trust in the assistant. So we would have to optimize a lot for high accuracy. So I would mention that as one of the, I would say, the downsides of the solution. And look at the second solution, which is Braille Keypad plus Primitive Voice Assistant. One problem or issue that it could bring up is consistency of Braille markings across the ATMs. If you don't have a consistent Braille marking across all of the ATMs, then you would have to ensure that the visually impaired person learns how the markings are done in your ATM, and then adopt your product, which is going to become a very hard task. And so we need to ensure that the markings are the same. The third solution on image recognition, for this, when I think about it, the problem which I'd already highlighted is raising a false alarm, and that is one of the downsides. Now, the last solution of ATM door lock, One problem that I could think of with this is, what if the person gets locked inside and is not able to unlock the door? For some reason, either the card does not work or the swiping mechanism doesn't work and you're not able to unlock the door. A solution that I can think of right now for this as a fallback method is to be able to enter your PIN on the keypad and be able to lock the door with that. So you have your first level of access, which is through the debit card, and your second level of access, in case your first level does not work, as a fallback, is to be able to key in your ATM PIN and then unlock the door based off of that. So I would think that this is a counter solution that we can build. Now that I've performed this entire analysis of what are the pros, cons with each of this solution, how easy it was to build, what is the impact of the customer, I would now want to prioritize amongst these four solutions and pick a few that I think I'd want to go with in my design. Out of my analysis, I would want to pick two of those. The first one is the Braille keypad plus primitive voice assistant, and then the second one is the ATM door lock. Now this concludes the step where I'm listing out solutions and evaluating the trade-offs. The final step for me is to now summarize the entire analysis and present my final recommendations in a logical manner. The way I would go about this is as follows. I would tell the interviewer this. We looked at the problem of designing an ATM for people who are visually impaired. We further narrowed down the scope of this question, and then we identified a particular user to whom we need to design this product for. After this, we went through the customer journey of this user in relation to using this specific product. I noted the needs of this particular customer in each of the phases of the customer journey. Out of these needs, I prioritized two needs. One of those was to transact seamlessly, and then the other is safety inside the ATM. Now that I had my prioritized needs ready, I went into the solutioning mode where I looked at four solutions, two each for each of the pain points. Out of these solutions, I then prioritized the solutions based off of three factors. One was impact, the other was complexity in building the solution, and the third piece was what are the future problems that each solution could have and whether we'd be able to build a counter solution to it or not. And out of this activity, I prioritized two solutions. One is the Braille keypad plus primitive voice assistant, and the second feature is the ATM door lock, which I'd want to go ahead with in my final design. So this concludes the answer for the design question of design an ATM for people who are visually impaired. One thing I'd want to mention here is that you could have gone ahead in a completely different manner. You could have prioritized a different set of needs and come up with a different set of solutions, which is completely fair, and it is in fact great, because at the end of the day, the interviewer is not checking whether you are right or wrong, but how you approach a problem. In all probability, you may never be designing an ATM as a PM in the real life, but what the interviewers want to see is, are you able to keep your calm and respond to ambiguous situations that are presented to you? The last thing is that the more you practice, the more natural you're going to get. So keep practicing, keep picking up design questions and solve those using this particular framework, and note down where you go wrong, what sort of areas you need to improve at. Now that brings us to the end of today's video on circles. Hope you guys enjoyed it. Hope you learned what circles framework is and how you apply it to a design question. If you liked the video, do give a thumbs up and mention in the comments below what kind of videos you'd want to see in the future. And so until next time, bye-bye.